Well, welcome tonight. So glad you're here with us on this Thanksgiving Eve, giving thanks. I'm going to invite my wife to come forward. And I pray that every heart just be ready to receive as the word goes forth. Again, welcome. If this is your first time, welcome. If you've been here many times, welcome.
Thank you, Lord. Let's just give him a great praise tonight. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You got more in the tank than that. If you don't, jump around a little bit. Come on. Don't be tired. Get up. Jump around. Run around. Woo! Than you did 2 seconds ago. And if you didn't get on your feet, I question why you couldn't get on your feet and praise the mighty God, King of Kings, Almighty God, who's given us all things we could ever ask or imagine. Then I think you should get to your feet and give him some praise tonight and thank him for all the blessings he's bestowed upon us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you're in the back, you can just move to the front. This is a family. It's Thanksgiving. This is a Friendsgiving tonight. Don't feel like you have to be on the outskirts. Come in. Snuggle up. We got room in the front. You guys can be seated once you find a close, comfortable seat. Please forgive me. This sweet baby boy, Johnny, really likes to be low, so I asked Joshua if I could sit and preach. So here I am. Real easy for the camera people. Not going to be moving a whole lot. You never know. You never know what the Lord's going to do. I might just do a Miles Millen and sprint around the room right now. I mean, I don't know. Just watch out. Watch out. Well, welcome, everyone, and welcome to all the guests. I'm Allie Spitsbergen, and I'm not the pastor. Pastor Mark is in Oregon, but so honored to be with you guys tonight, and especially on the eve of Thanksgiving. And how fitting. I, you know, was feeling about sharing about giving thanks and living a life of continual thanksgiving. Not one day, but 365 days a year of continual thanksgiving. How many of you guys live like that? Amen. Amen. That's the life of Christ right there. Constantly giving thanks in all things, right? How many of you guys can think of the most thankful person you know? Like they just shoot into your head. You can just think of the person, the most thankful person you know. I pray that people say that about us. Amen? Like, oh gosh, that Melody, she is so thankful. She's just amazing. Like for me, it's my mom. I sent her flowers. Those flowers got there. I got a picture of her with the flowers. I got a sweet text. I got a FaceTime. I got another picture with the flowers. Like she is just the most thankful person. She, you know that she's so thankful for everything. Then there's the people where you're like, you send a gift and you're like, for sure it got stolen off their doorstep because you haven't heard anything in months. And you're like, did you ever get that? And we're all busy and crazy and stuff like that. But sometimes you're like, maybe just I got it would be awesome, you know, so you don't rebuy the same thing or call the post office. But you know what's amazing about the thankful people? They're happy people, right? They're full of the Holy Ghost, mostly, right? I hope. But they're very happy. Happy people are thankful people, and thankful people are happy. And so there's such a key that the Lord wants to lock in people tonight. And the Lord's here. How radical that we get to be in the house of God, you know, all the time. Today in the checkout line, Anna told someone that we're in church every day. And they go, you are? And I said, well, yeah, you know, we have church every day, but we actually go to a building Wednesdays and Sundays. She's like, wow, like this huge commitment. I was like, you can have church every day too. It's pretty radical. And so anyway, does the Bible say anything about giving thanks? Bible's all about giving thanks, right? It's not about grumbling, complaining, whining. All you mommies and, you know, babyhood, that's probably what we're constantly saying. No whining, no complaining. Give thanks in all things. We're giving thanks. Maybe we're not all in mommyhood, but that's where we're at right now. But I want to start us off in 2 Chronicles 5:13. And if anyone needs healing in your body, you don't have to wait for an hour till I'm done. You can receive it right now. If anyone's sick among us, anything, you can put your hands up, receive that healing now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. All that healing. Look at you guys. By his stripes, you are healed, and you are going to feel so good. So good. All right, 2 Chronicles, everyone there? Kind of cheated. I grabbed all my scripture and threw it in a Word doc. Okay, so it says, indeed, it came to pass when the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard and praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. That the house of the Lord was filled, then the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud. Guys, I love getting into this place and just regardless of what happens during the day, the first thing I do is just whoosh, hands up. Surrender the day, surrender how I'm feeling, surrender the tiredness, surrender the kids, maybe going crazy, who can know, right? Like just throwing my hands up and just saying, Father, I'm here not because I need to be here. I'm here to praise you and give you thanks and give you all the praise and glory. And guys, the second we do that, I've come here sick. I've come here literally, I threw up before I walked in the place and put my hands up and was like instantly healed. And I mean, there's so many testimonies of even my sister, I know one time was on the stage very sick. I mean, there's so many testimonies of just coming into his presence with your heart right, ready to receive, to give praise and thanksgiving where everything goes, but we can come in and just be like, oh my gosh, this worship is so long. My seat stinks. This person smells. This person like sure on didn't bath like for the past 5 years. Oh my gosh, if Elizabeth keeps sitting up there, oh no. Right? Right? I saw some of you guys like that tonight. I'm like, are they kidding? Why aren't their hands in the air? Like I was almost going to come lift him up tonight because tonight the Lord's allowed me to minister. But I couldn't imagine coming in this house. Maybe some churches, sure, do your thing. Not in this house where the presence and the glory of God is so present to be able to walk in here and be like, right? Like, it's just like, oh, I don't even know how I could do that ever. And one big thing for me is like, pastor would say like the glory cloud or like it's getting foggy in here. And I'm like, where is it? Where is it? Right? And I was like, I don't see that, but I want to see that. And I pressed in for that, Lord. I'm like, Lord, I want to see the fogginess. I want to see it get so foggy in here that I can't see anyone in there because your glory is so present. And guess what? 8 years later, every time we're in worship, boom, I start seeing the glory cloud and it starts getting foggy. And I love it and I want more of it. And I want to press in to have more of the presence of God, more of that. But it comes when I come and I don't care about anything else, even my own children. I remember pastor, I was like, well, they're all going crazy. And he goes, listen, you touch heaven and it'll work itself out. I said, amen. All right, let's do this, Lord. That's way better than like, shh, quiet, gotcha, right? Getting distracted and then yourself feeling really exhausted. And so anyway, I pray that we press in with that praise and thanksgiving every single time we come in here. I pray if I just get on your grill a little bit and you don't like me anymore because I just called you out for sitting there, that's fine. Because I want you to enter into this. I do. I do not care, you know, really about my reputation and anything like that in the house tonight. I love you all. I hope you know that. And I know you know that. But I do care about you entering in to the presence, the holies of holies, where he's invited us in, you guys. It unleashes so much in your life. It unleashes this, like, amazing, amazing, incredible feeling of like, Lord, it's all about you, nothing about me, where our self is so not into that. Our self's like, what about me? How do I feel? Do I look good? Is this good? Da, da, da. I'm thirsty. I'm hungry. I gotta be like, right? Like all that stuff goes out the window when you just put your hands up because you're praising and giving him thanks. And everything you need flows out from heaven. Hello, everything you need, sickness in your body, finances, anything. It just goes and it's so instant when we get in here and we put our hands up to praise him. And so we're going to jump right into Jeremiah 30:19. I love this scripture. I say that all the time. I love everything about the Word of God. Praise God. Amen for that. Jeremiah 30:19. says, then out of them shall proceed thanksgiving and the voice of those who make merry. I will multiply them, and they shall not diminish. I will also glorify them, and they shall not be. Amen. Amen. We're giants in the faith in this place, that's for sure. But you guys, how amazing is that? That we should proceed with thanksgiving. The voice of those will be merry. I will multiply them. They shall not diminish it. I will also glorify them. Philippians 4:6. I think this is one of the most quoted scriptures, yet I think one of the biggest pieces that people miss out is this huge monster fat word we're talking about tonight. Starts with T, ends with G. Tell me when you guys are there. I know we're going quick. I know you guys have turkeys in the oven probably, right? Just kidding. Maybe that's tomorrow. I don't cook very well. Working on that. Doing a ham tomorrow. Last year was quite a trip with my first Thanksgiving. My mom and dad are watching. Glad you're having your own this year. No, it was amazing. Amazing, amazing. All right, so Philippians 4:6. It says, be anxious for everything, all things. Go crazy, be anxious. No, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. Keyword, highlight, asterisk, star, circle, right here. Thanksgiving with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God. It never ceases to amaze me when people are in a predicament and things are not going right, that they're like, oh, be anxious for nothing but everything. Give prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be known to God. Doesn't God already know my issues? My car's broke down. I have no tires. I have no gas, and I'm broke. Like, does God not know? I'm like, sister, not so thankful, not so thankful. Like, maybe thank God anyway that you had the car that, you know, lost its wheels, had no gas, and that you're broke. I mean, in all things, give thanks. In all things. You know, I think we're so blessed to be under such a radical pastor where, like, the bank account's zero. He's like, thank you, Jesus, that you're providing $500,000 tonight that we need for this. You're like, $500,000? Like, maybe $5, $10, but $500,000? Like, you need. But that's what he walks into. And you know what he says? He doesn't go around crying. What does he do? He starts giving thanks and praise, dancing around like a crazy, and all of a sudden gets a phone call, and someone's like, hey, yeah, we got this, blah, 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 or some random dude shows up at the doorsteps like, hey, this, you know, crazy, crazy things. But when we sit there and we're like, woe is me, I have to pick up 52 nursing shift overnights, and then I have to cancel Christmas, next New Year's, I have to return all the clothes to the store, and then, yeah, I better give up everything else too, right? And then, No. God's not calling us to go there, but it's so easy to get in these situations where we don't trust God. We don't have thanksgiving. Woe is me. Elizabeth's blessed. I'm not. She gets this. I get that, huh? Right? Does that ever happen? Of course. We're always checking people out. Like, well, what about them? Did you see what I did? I moved all the chairs all week. No one said anything to me. Right? But if we always have that constant praise and thanksgiving, we're not going to fall into that. We're going to constantly be giving praise and things that we could give a rip. And we're grateful that Cade showed up 5 hours early to do this and that Manny's doing his job in the kingdom, right? God's going to bless that. God's going to answer those prayers. And I love this. It says we would worry less if we praised more. Thanksgiving is the enemy of discontentment and dissatisfaction. Come on. We all know those people that just can go straight into the dissatisfaction with everything. We all know those people that are like, praise Jesus so that I had water today. I don't care that it was mucky and gross, but I had water, right? Like that was amazing. I'm sure all these Overland kids that were just here felt like they were in paradise for a couple weeks being home from the Congo, right? Absolutely. So when we come into church, we should immediately be putting our hands up and giving thanksgiving, whatever we have. We shouldn't be anxious. We shouldn't bring all of our garbage of the day and all the things that didn't work out and how bad the boss was and that I failed my biology test and all that stuff. God says, don't be anxious about that. Don't worry. Don't worry. I got you. Just come in, put your hands up, give thanks. Let those requests be made known to God. He does know them, but there's a communion. If I didn't talk to my husband, I was just like, oh, he knows it. Yeah, he knows that one too. What kind of relationship will we have? There's a communion. There's a communication that we have, making our knowns requests known to each other. But how much more to Heavenly Father, like you said, that pours out all things. The Ephesians 3:20, God. So in Psalms 104, it talks about the four things to be joyful about. And I love this. I think, you know, there should be more worship songs about this. Right? And then maybe we just staple it to our heads so then we all remember when we come in here what this means. Or maybe we'll just put it on the front door. Maybe our ushers and greeters can remind everyone, hello, Psalm 104, are you ready to go? Enter into his gates with? And into his courts with? Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Guys, there's no excuse for coming in here and feeling sorry for yourself and hanging your head low, making weird faces and worried about things. Seriously. I'm not on the worship team, but I do look around, obviously, to see how everyone's doing, making sure all my friends are here, right? But I couldn't imagine sometimes being on the worship team and seeing people like, it's like, whoa, hello, hello, disconnect. Have we even touched the word of God today? Have we had prayer time? Like, where are we at, right? Right? Brad's in it. Brad's ready to go. He's at his prayer time. You know, I love when Pastor told us that we have to start waking up and dancing around the room. I'm almost 6 months preggers, and when I wake up, I'm like, whoa, okay, here we go. My kids are already up and stuff, and I'm like, little dance. Lord, this is weak. But honestly, I've been pressing in for more, to like have more of a dance, and now it's getting a little better. But I wake up, and I don't need coffee. I don't need tea. I'm like, I'm in the dance. I'm in the praise. I'm in the Thanksgiving. Is anyone else there? It is such a powerful act just to get up and just get into the dance and just to get into the praise and Thanksgiving. It sets your mind for the entire day. And so one powerful thing, too, for people that are not thankful or ungrateful or really need to focus on this is a practice of emailing or writing 3 people each day to say how thankful you are for them. How powerful is that? You know, the word says in Philippians 4:8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. You know, like when you get a Subaru and then all of a sudden there's like 5,000 Subarus, it's not that everyone went to the Subaru dealership and followed you and bought the Subaru, but your mind is like thinking Subaru because you just bought one and you're seeing them all, right? Same is true with Thanksgiving and praise. If you're constantly giving thanks and you're constantly giving praise, you're going to constantly find things to give thanks for and you're constantly going to give praise. If you're constantly grumbling and constantly complaining and woe is me life, you're going to constantly be in woe is me life. And we all know those people, right? That's why you're all laughing, because we constantly, I mean, Thanksgiving, people are like, oh no, the in-laws, da 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 da. And I want to be like, they produced your husband. Like, he's not so bad. You married him. What's wrong with the in-laws? Like, honestly, sometimes I'm like, what? But, like, I think it's the bread of the dream. I mean, praise God, I got the best, so I don't have to deal with it. And I think my parents are pretty awesome. I don't know if my sister-in-laws do. No, I'm just kidding. They do. But, I mean, honestly, when people go into Thanksgiving and family events, like, oh, I've been worried about this for 364 days. I'm like, they're cooking you food and inviting you to their home. That's pretty sweet. Like, let's flip this around. Or, oh, I always get this for Christmas. And da-da. They bought you a gift. They went out of their way to use their money to sit in a line. Hopefully they did online, but maybe they went to a line and sat there for you because they thought of you. I don't care if it's underwear with the Grinch. Like, right? Who cares? If you constantly have this practice of Thanksgiving, I promise you it will change your life. And I know there's a lot of people that need to hear that tonight, because I actually was going to talk about prayer and fasting, which I'm going to finish with. But a lot of us in this place need to know that there's an advantage in being thankful and grateful at all times. In fact, so funny, we had a huge convention, and they paid this mega speaker who did this great work out of Harvard about the happiness advantage. And I sat in the 2-hour presentation. I thought, that's all Bible. That's from the Bible. That's Bible too. Yeah, you could have just read the Bible. You didn't have to do all this research with all these different Ivy League schools and go to all these hospitals, these Fortune 500 companies and that. Like, you just be happy and you give thanks in all things and there's going to be great outcomes. And that's what they found. These companies are exceeding above all other things because all the employees are happy and they give thanks and they're praised. I'm like, hello. And then same with the hospitals, great outcome with the patients because, you know, they're always thanked and praised. And you guys, it's really a huge, you know, epiphany to most people when they want to not give thanks and praise. And so, you know, Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so he is." If we're constantly praising and giving thanks for everything, like the air in your lungs and the clothes on your back, you're going to constantly be thinking about those things. You're going to be consumed by those things. So there was kind of a fun thing a couple years ago, this millennial generation, where it's like, I mean, just even like 2 weeks ago after the election, they had to like buy them pizza, pop, and bring in psychologists, and they couldn't go to school, and, you know, it was kind of crazy. And I know we have radical millennials that doesn't even touch. But anyway, so they were like feeling sorry for themselves and like, oh, my house isn't big enough, and I need da-da-da-da. And so a bunch of parents were like, you're going to sleep on the streets. We're going to do a night on the streets. You're going to sleep with the homeless, and then you're going to come home and be very grateful. And so I don't know who headed it up, if it was a Christian crew or whatnot, but these kids did not sleep 1 ounce on the street with a cardboard box, and they were begging mommy and daddy to pick them up the next day with a whole new insight of gratefulness, thanksgiving, and praise for what they did have. And I was blessed. My dear dad, who's amazing, we would go down to the holidays in Chicago, and it's always beautiful, and stay in a nice hotel and, you know, do a show and Jesus Christ Superstar or something fun like that. And we would drive down Lower Wacker Drive. And Manny's the only one in this whole house that knows what that is. And back in the day, it used to be where all the homeless really slept. And he would look out there and he said, be grateful for all the things that the Lord's given us. God has been good to us. And it made me as a little child realize that we have been so blessed abundantly, that like, why aren't I on the streets? And I think I would ask them too, like, why aren't we on the streets? Like, why do we have a nice house? Why were we able to stay at a hotel? Why were we allowed to do these things? And it birthed in me this passion to have such compassion for other people and such a thanksgiving for anything I did have. And so when I was in nursing school, I was broke. Anyone else in college? Broke, right? As a joke. So I used to run Lakeshore Drive, again, Manny's the only one that knows this area, on the north side of Chicago, and there was three homeless men that were on this bench like every single day. And I knew they loved Jesus. I just did. It was just a weird thing. Like, they were just happy and joyful. They were giving thanks for nada. They had nothing. And so one day I just started talking to them, and I realized they were the most grateful, thankful people, big smiles on their face, always waiting to make sure I made my run, made it back. And so one day I said, you guys like peanut butter and jelly sandwiches? And they're like, man, we like anything. I was like, I'm going to run home and make some PBJs. So then I started this like homeless ministry with these three guys, bringing peanut butter and jellies on my run, small scale. But you know what? I wanted to do something. So then I moved here to San Diego. I knew not a soul. I had my black lab golden retriever, Tara. That was my only friend. And I thought about that. I thought about, man, that was pretty radical to get to know these people in Chicago because I was kind of new to the north side. And I'm going to go meet the homeless of San Diego. And so me and Tara pack up. We go down there. Bottled water this time. You know, I had a job. Bottled water, PBJs, and I think that might have been it. And we just met some grateful, thankful people, even though they're on the streets. And I met this girl, Wendy, and she said, I'm on the streets because I'm the mom of the streets. I got to take care of these little people that are coming out, and this is my ministry. And it was just so radical meeting these people that weren't feeling sorry for themselves. They had nothing, but really were like, you know, hey, this is what we're doing. You know, God's still good. God still reigns. And so it was funny. I got a roommate and her husband worked at Chick-fil-A. And I said, hey, you're not open on Sundays. So what do you do with the food on Saturdays? And she's like, well, you know, sometimes we trash it. And I said, no. Saturday night's my night. I'm going to come repackage it all. We're going to the streets. So I'm driving down. I'm like, I used to have peanut butter and jelly. I have Chick-fil-A for hundreds of people now, downtown San Diego. And they just thought that we were having like the Queen's Buffet every single Saturday. And it was just so radical. But you know what it taught me? Every single night I'd come home from that, I would put my head on a soft pillow, a warm blanket. And I was like, thank you, Jesus, so much for just these necessities. I need nothing else. I have a roof over my head. I'm warm. I got a great pillow. And I encourage you, if you struggle with this area, if you're real with yourself or you do feel ungrateful and woe is me and depressed and sad because God left you out and he doesn't listen to you, make a change in your life. Start giving more. Start really looking into other people's lives that have it way worse than you. And you'll start saying, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord. I praise you for all these things you've given me, right? It's huge, and I want to continue that with my own kids. And missions is a great opportunity for that, you guys. You can just go to Tijuana. You can just go right here in our backyard and see people living in massive poverty. And so I love this. And this is 2 Corinthians 9:11. Is anyone learning anything? Any of this good? Oh, Amy's receiving. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God is so good, so faithful, so generous. It's unreal to me. All right, you guys there? It's an easy book. We're there a lot. It says, you will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous. Cheap? Generous. On some occasions? Every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God because of the service by which you have proved yourselves. Men will praise God for that obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else and in their prayers. For you, their hearts will go. The glory cloud's coming in at Gary. That's right. Glory. For their hearts will go out because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Guys, this is a command. It's not like, oh, I hope I'm thankful. The thanksgiving we give on to other people, they then give glory to God for our obedience. That's radical, guys. That is so radical for us to be able to be givers, cheerful givers, that people are going to give thanksgiving unto God because of what we do and that we listen to his commandments. It says in Psalm 107:8, oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for all his wonderful works to the children of men. If you don't know how to live this Christian life, let me help you out. In Colossians 3:15-17, wait for you guys to get there. And it says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Guys, it's a command to us as Christian living, as our worship to the Lord Jesus Christ, that in all things, word and deed, that we give thanks. In all things. I praise God I married Joshua. Guess what? If I try to feel sorry for myself, he's like, babe, let's give some thanks. I'm like, all right, that wasn't going by him. babe, doesn't sound like you're giving thanks. Okay, yeah, I'm going to start giving thanks a little more. Okay, here we go. Because there's times that we just don't feel thankful or we just feel like blah or anything like that. And so one thing I started doing is just journaling things I was thankful for. Like very simple practice, put a journal by your bedside, write down, thankful for my hot husband. I'm thankful that he doesn't let me get away with complaining. I'm thankful for my beautiful kids. I'm thankful for air in my lungs. And man, it quit. I think I'm doing better, right? since I started journaling. Thank you. No, just kidding. But it really flipped it for me where I didn't let myself get exhausted. Motherhood, parenthood, all that stuff. You get exhausted sometimes. Your jobs, you get exhausted. And that's when Satan comes in to steal, kill, destroy by your mouth because you want to start saying, you're heaping curse upon yourself, right? Like, I remember one day I was probably going off on something. Who can even know? And Joshua's like, babe, whoosh. Like, you're not going to be blessed. Your business isn't going to be blessed. Our family's not going to get blessed. So let's just restart that whole thing. I was like, you're right. And then I got on the phone call with a business partner. She's like, no. I'm like, oh, sister, let me teach you something. Joshua just taught me. You're not going to be blessed. You keep talking like that. They're not going to get blessed. And this whole thing's not going to be good. And she was like, thank you. I needed that because I just got off the phone with someone else who jumped in and chimed in with me. And I really wasn't feeling good when I picked up the phone to talk to you. And it's true. I love having people in my life that, you know, iron sharpens iron. I love being in this house. Why? Because it's not comfortable to sit in the seat. So many times I'm like, Pastor just totally read my journal. Like, oh, wow. Like, anyone feel like he reads your mail every time you come to church? Like, I'm pretty sure that was for me too. And that was me too. Okay, that one, that was definitely me. Okay, now I'm going to call, this is me too. Right? But I want to be corrected. I'll take mine now, right? I do not want to stand before the Lord uncorrected as an unruly child that was never disciplined. No, I want to take the chastening now. I want to be corrected. I want to move into greater things with God. And so for me, that's so important. I only preach on things like this is me. Like, I'm preaching to myself. So I'm glad you all showed up. But like, I'm preaching to myself tonight and reminder of in all word and all deed that I'm going to give thanks for all things. And you can all hold me accountable. This is a big accountability party that you all came to. So that's why I wanted you all to move in closer, you know, get up in each other's grill. So 2 Corinthians 4:15-16. This is so good. Being renewed day by day. I love this scripture. It says, for all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being what? Renewed day by day. Guys, that is so radical. Our inward man is being renewed day by day. And that while we're giving thanks, abounding to the glory, we're being refreshed by the Lord. There's nothing worse than when you really feel bad and then you just hang out with people that really take you down to the next level and down. And then you get around Holy Ghost-filled people that are so encouraging and building you up and being renewed day by day. And you're like, wow, I could take on a troop. I could, you know, run this race. I could go to Romania and save the nation. Like, you just feel so empowered, right? By staying in that disposition of being thankful and giving thanks. All right, two more scriptures on this, and then we're moving into some heavy stuff. Everyone doing okay? Everyone's like, what is that pregnant lady talking about? Okay, first and last. Okay, well, let's just talk about this. Hold on. Charles Spurgeon said, there should be a parallel between our supplications and our thanksgivings. We ought not to leap in prayer and limp in praise. Good stuff, huh? We ought not leap in prayer, yet limp in praise. How many of you feel like your praise tonight was limp? You don't have to raise your hand. Like, I used to be a little crazier dancing around and stuff like that. Then I realized the baby has to stay until March 17th, so I might not have to do that the whole time. But in my heart, I just want to, like, jump and around. Like, I can't just sit still, like, ever. One of the funny things is I'm like, Joshua, I don't even think you know who I was. He's like, yeah, you were the one dancing around in the back going crazy. I was like, oh, yeah. When I first came to your church, I was like, okay, cool. What does everyone do? All right. And I just come from a church where everyone just jumped up in front, like this massive like praise and worship party. I'm like, let's do this. Like, I can't literally sit in my chair. Like, I have to get up and praise. Well, same with my prayer life. My prayer life isn't like, hey, God, what's up? It's cool. No, I don't pray like that. Jack, do we pray like that? No. I almost crashed the car driving here 3 times. When we were like, oh, I was going to tell you about that car. I'm like, oh, sorry. So I've got my sick of sitting in it. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 1:4. It says, I always thank God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, in all your speaking and in all your knowledge, because of our testimony about Christ was confirmed in you. Therefore, I love that word. What is it there for? You do not lack. Okay? No one here. No one lacks. Nothing. Nada. No. You do not lack any spiritual gifts as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will keep you strong, not weak, strong to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. One of my favorite books by Smith Wigglesworth was Faith That Prevails. And he says, and truly the word of God changes a man until he becomes an epistle of God. It transforms his mind, changes his character, moves him on from grace to grace, makes him an inheritor of the very nature of God. Guys, that's radical stuff. God comes in, dwells in, walks in, talks through, and sits with him who opens his being to the word of God and receives the Spirit who inspired it. Powerful, huh? The whole book's amazing. Smith Wigglesworth's life, pastors talked about it a ton. He was totally given over to righteousness, totally given his life over to the pursuit of God. And so, in closing, I just want to share this. We've had so many evangelists and teachers come through Abiding Place Ministry. We have been so extraordinarily blessed. Truly, the best of the best have sat in this chair, which makes me totally humbled every single moment. I woke up this morning and I go, babe, do you want to preach? I think you should take it tonight. I really think you should. He's like, no, you got it. I'm like, Lord, I got it. And then just totally filled with the joy. And you're just starting to laugh. And you're like, yeah, I'm just a Chicago kid with a few medical degrees. And you can use me because guess what? I'm wide open, right? I have no preconceived notions that everyone has to like me tonight or everyone think that I'm the smartest biblical scholar that doesn't have a PhD and I probably shouldn't be up here. That's not important to me. What's important to me is that the Lord uses me to enrich your lives, the people that are watching on the webs, but more importantly, the people on the streets that aren't even in these four walls tonight, that you're going to go forth and be such an abundance of blessing to all these people and thanksgiving and blessing. And by your obedience, they're going to give thanks to God because of you guys. And so, man, I get so fired up. I was telling my husband, I said, when people come through here, like Debbie sharing stories about revival in a nursing home, I'm like wanting to look up every nursing home in San Diego. I'm like, clearly I can go talk to some senile people and preach and see something happen, right? Like, they're not even going to remember me. And then the Lord reminded me I was actually a CNA at senile hospitals. And like, that's what I actually did. And I started a Bible study with 80 to 90 year olds because they were going to go to heaven. And we started the purpose-driven life, a little Catholic. I'm like, okay, purpose-driven life, day one, here we go. And then my adorable mom took it over when I headed off to the mission field. And then those same sweet people actually made hats, and we called them Helmets of Righteousness, to fund me with YWAM. So I had a little grandma sweatshop back in Chicago making these Helmets of Righteousness that were still studying the Word of God and being loved on by Mama Bear. And just radical stuff, but just being available, right? Just being available and being obedient. God's going to use it. And so I love her story about the gift of faith for finances. I mean, we're constantly putting these positions where, like, right now we're putting up a church at, up in the MTC, and, we're going to Cuba, and then Pastor just talked about Switzerland and Finland and Venezuela and Ecuador. I think Sandy was telling me yesterday. Where are you, Sandy? I lost you. She's not there. Hi, Sandy. But anyway, all these things that we need to be increased in our faith to do, and I feel like the Lord brings these men and women of God for us to be increased in faith, not to be like, great speaker. Love that, Pastor Tim, man. He's a funny guy. No, to go home, study what they've done, to come earnestly. I loved how Debbie said, I'm not here for you guys. I'm actually here to receive everything from the house. So excuse me why I come for my selfish reasons. I feel the same way. I'm like, no, I want everything you have. And I actually told her, I'm like, can I have all your notes too? She's like, sure, sweetheart. I'm like, I want to run with that mantle that you have and what you've done and what you've seen. And, when Tim Hall came, he spoke by the Lord on fasting for this house. And pastors also talked about fasting and praying. And we used to have those Saturdays where we were fasting and praying as a house. And pastor really put a strong encouragement word to us to follow the leader, follow what he does, follow that prayer and fasting. Don't let it just be someone that says, okay, we're going to come on Saturdays. Make it a practice in your own lives to benefit you, to build you up. And so I know it's comical having an almost 6 months pregnant woman closing about prayer and fasting the night before Thanksgiving. My sister thought it was funny when I told her last night on the couch. She goes, oh, the night before Thanksgiving, prayer and fasting. Yeah. So, but I really feel like the Lord wanted me to share with you and encourage you what he's done in and through it in my own life and make a call for us tonight that we need to move into. A lot of people are scared by the words fasting, freaked out. In fact, someone at this church told me they're having issues, and I said, have you fasted about it? She goes, no, but God's calling me to do it, but that freaks me out. And I'm like, well, don't let it freak you out. Let it build faith in you, because that could just be the breakthrough that the Lord's been putting on you to see this breakthrough in your marriage. And so fasting and prayer is a weapon of warfare. You know, Pastor Tim did an amazing job. We had School of the Spirit 2-3 Fridays ago. Watch the web on Tim Hall Wednesday. It was Wednesday night of his. No, Thursday night. Thursday, Tim Hall, and then 3 weeks ago Friday was Pastor Mark in prayer and fasting. So I'm not going to go over all their notes, but when we pray and fast, we release great things in the Spirit. It unlocks prophetic insight, putting everything else aside and having God as our only focus. Some references there, if you're taking notes, 2 Chronicles 23, Daniel, amazing, Daniel 10, 3 to 15, Daniel 9, 1 Samuel 31. Am I doing okay on time? When the kids start crying, then I know it's getting late. So I just want to close with you guys with two examples of what the Lord did in and through prayer and fasting. And so when I first got saved, I was with Youth with a Mission, YWAM. It's a discipleship training school in Australia, Thailand, and New Zealand. And we had an outreach. So you sat there and you learned, but you don't sit, soak, and sour, right? You know how a pastor's like, don't sit here, soak here, and sour here. No. Like, get going. Like, when the Overland people were like, the green light, like, it's all green, y'all. Like, you don't have to wait. There's no red. Peace out. Pastor loves that. I mean, this is the ever-changing place, right? They come in, they go out. They come in, they go out. And so anyway, you get this four-month opportunity to learn about the Lord and all these different discipleship training things. And then you have a night where you hear from the Lord, and then you're given three opportunities for outreach where you're going to put everything you've learned into action. And there was three different outreaches. There was one to the orphans, one to the kids' school, one to the prostitutes. I'm like, oh, Lord, clearly I've been nannying since I was like 12 years old. I love children. I'm going to go to, and I love orphans, obviously. The whole business is around it. Obviously, you know, you're going to send me to the orphanage. No. So I was like, well, I'll just go pray and hear from the voice of the Lord, put this into action, right? So I'm sitting in my tent and I'm praying, and immediately I heard in my spirit, Jeremiah 3. I'm like, what? And that was new for me to hear from the Lord. Like, I didn't really know that. Usually I'm like, oh, okay. Oh, yeah, that sounds good. You know, one of these guys. Oh, Lord, did you speak this? Okay. And I hear Jeremiah 3. Well, in Jeremiah 3, there's not a whole lot about orphans. It's a whole lot about prostitutes. And I was like, yeah, I didn't hear him right. And then it was like Jeremiah 3. And then I like try to do like this guy, like, oh, let me try to find the orphans. And then it's like Jeremiah 3. And I was like, Lord, surely you don't want me to go to work the prostitutes. This is 24/7. This isn't just a week. This is several months where I'm going to be living integrated with prostitutes. Clearly, I have nothing to say to them, nor can I do anything. Not so true. Anyone ever wrestle with God? Think he's wrong? You're totally right because you have this awesome background of whatever junk. Like, seriously. So I wake up the next day and I go to tell this staff member. I said, you know, the prostitutes. And he's like, yeah, I know. I'm like, what? And he's like, yeah, you're going to lead the team, you know, into the prostitutes at Pattaya. I was like, who's doing the orphans, right? Like, my first thing. And so I was like, okay, yeah. So a couple weeks before that, we heard about prayer and fasting. And I thought, wow, Lord, this might be the time that I need to pray and fast. Like, going into the prostitutes of Pattaya, like the number one place with brothels, red lights, and me. So I thought, okay, I'm going to start fasting. This is great. 7-day fast. And so I knew a few things about fasting from the Word of God, but I knew I needed vision. Like, what did I want to see? And I was so funny that I thought, okay, Lord, I just want to see one woman come out, give her life to Jesus, be made white and pure, white as snow, pure virgin bride of you. That's all I want, one person. So I fasted for 7 days. It was a pretty ugly thing. I'm like, oh my gosh, I think I'm going to die. And then anyone else feel like that on your first fast? Like, you're for sure going to die. And you're like, I really hope there's medics on the staff because I'm going to die in the backwoods of Australia. I didn't die. I did good. God did good in through me. So anyway, moving on. The first night we get to Thailand, first of all, we were supposed to go to Bali. We weren't even supposed to be in Thailand. We get to Thailand, and a staff member, Janelle, who did all of our hair for our wedding, and I stay up till 4 in the morning. We had the exact same testimony, exact, to like the T. I'm like, this is the weirdest thing in all the world that I meet a girl that we have the same testimony. And the Lord's like, I hooked you up for a reason. And she was there full-time on staff with Rehab Ministries doing the prostitute work. She was a hairstylist. She was going in, pulling them out, teaching them hair to give them another trade so they don't have to worry about prostitution and supporting their families. And so I told her, you know, I said, you know, I come here ready to do the work of Jesus. Like, and she goes, well, bringing shoes and bringing clothes isn't really what we do here. What we do is we deliver them from demons and set them free. And I'm like, oh, right. Right. What? Like, awesome. And so she shared with me about all the demons that were cast out in the Bible and what that looked like, and that these people truly were demonically oppressed and that they had been given over because of all the sexual immorality. And guys, this was heavy stuff. I'm like month 4 into being a Christian, right? Like, and had a Catholic background. So I'm like, wow, this is awesome, Lord. Thanks for that fast. I'm sure we're going to break through every demon, every stronghold. Like, we got this. You got this. And so the next thing was that the next night, the staff prayed over us six, and it was prophesied, Jeremiah 22:22 over me, and it said, and the keys of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder, so he shall open, and none shall shut, and he shall shut, and none shall open. Supernaturally, doors began to open in this ministry for the little girl that believed God to pray and fast. Supernaturally, bars were open to us. Different ministries wanted to be a part of us and connect with us. And then supernaturally, I was giving the gift of the Thai language. And these people had been on the ground for a year, and they're like, how do you know the language? I'm like, I don't. They're like, you speak it perfectly. I'm like, this is Jesus. This is totally supernaturally what I prayed for. My vision was set for, and this is God hooking up with it. And then the whole staff's like, we're fasting for the rest of the time till everyone starts, you know, talking like this. No, but it was just radical. I just started seeing the fruits in the ministry because I knew I wasn't there long, but I knew that God saw my heart when I was praying and fasting to see these breakthroughs and to see him quick. And so the first night we went out to the red light district and brothels, and this might scare some of you guys, but I feel like when you've seen this and you've lived it, you can't be silent. And I won't be silent because this goes on just in our backyards right here in San Diego. But the first night we were out, a young lady started calling out to me and she said, sexy, sexy, come, you're beautiful. You model, you movie star. And they pretty much line the streets and say this to everyone. And then she said, you are so beautiful with a haiti dai, which meant with a good heart. And immediately the Lord drew me back to this girl. And so I started talking to her in my broken Thai and her broken English, and I invited her to our English class the next day. We left that bar, and I prayed like I've never prayed before, praying in the Holy Ghost, probably one of the first times that I had activated the gift of tongues I had been given a couple weeks prior. And I just started going for it, up and down those brothels, that this girl, Da, was going to be at English class, and that she was going to be my night one, set free from all these demonic strongholds. And so I stayed up that whole night praying for this girl. And I sat there eagerly at English class the next day waiting for her to come in the door. And guess who came through the door? Da came through the door, biggest smile on her face. She beelined me, threw me back with the hug. I'm like, we are meant to be best friends. That's how I love greeting people. And so she listened to the English class. She was so excited. And at the end of English class, the only reason we did English is because we wanted to give them a free gift that they could learn English to get out of the prostitution. So at the end, we always ask, who needs prayer? And Da's hand was the first one to shoot up. I wrote this straight out of my journal today. So thankfully, we were with people that were equipped in the deliverance ministries, and we all went to lay hands on her. It was the first time I felt Jesus' authority over demons and strongholds in this precious life, this precious girl. And when we were done, she felt a peace, a joy, a release when we prayed. She completely looked like a new person. I'm not going to cry. Pregnant. The next 2 months were full of so many signs, wonders, and miracles because I continued to press in, I continued to fast and pray, and I knew that the Lord was going to protect us, and I knew that in these bars, even though our lives were threatened more than once, that He would keep us in this perfect peace. It was such a radical time of intense ministry, but such an intimacy with Jesus that I've never known before. Like I said, when those Overland Mission leaders sat here, they said, there's a green light, just go. God can give you a red light when you're there. It's so true. You don't have to have any degrees nor qualifications to be mightily by God. You just need to go. Jesus, Moses, Daniel, David, Elijah, John the Baptist, and the rest practiced continual prayer. And because of this, they had more power and more authority than anyone else. They prayed without ceasing. Do you know what that means? Power and authority from on high. I realized that the rule of the kingdom, that if you give up something good, you receive something of a greater value. If you give up your rights and receive greater privileges, you receive greater privileges with God. After I came home from Thailand, I was wrecked for the ordinary. I felt the Lord call me to do a 40-day fast. I felt so desperate to know Jesus more and to walk like He walked and talk like He talked. I know Tim Hall just came and he said he would go out to the mountains just to seek God, just to know Him. I had no idea where I was going to stay. I had no idea how I was going to get places. And nothing was set up. And then my visa in Australia all of a sudden was unable to be renewed while everyone else's was. And I was booted out to New Zealand. True story. After I was called to fast. I at least knew a few people in Australia. I knew no one in New Zealand. But in Acts 17:26, He said, and He made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation, that they would seek God, if perhaps they might look for Him and find Him, though He is not far from each of us, for in Him we live and move and exist. From the second my feet hit the ground in New Zealand, door after door was open. That same prophecy I got back in Thailand after my fast. I stayed with the sweetest Fijian family missionary my first week, and they introduced me to a homeowner of a beach house called Emmanuel. It was located on the beach of northern New Zealand, and I had the entire place of prayer and fasting just with Jesus, with some of the most gorgeous scenery I've ever seen in my entire life. Halfway through there, I was welcomed to another gorgeous place called Gideon Fields. Prayers during the time like this was for my family's vision, my family's salvation. You always have to have vision and prayer and fasting of what you're going at. I remember sitting at this place, Gideon Fields, and getting an email from my youngest brother, Matt, saying that he started to go to a Bible study and he's starting to like it. And that same Bible study, my brother gave his life to the Lord. Psalm 32:8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you shall go. I will guide you with my eye. I didn't know my next step, and I ended up sleeping in a bedroom at an office of a lady who actually married the founder of Mercy Ship Boats. Anyone know what Mercy Ships are? They go into unreached people groups and they do surgeries to the farthest out people that never heard the gospel. My heart has always been to be a part of Mercy Ships, and that's the reason why I ever even did a discipleship training school for YWAM. And now on day 26 of my fast, I'm with the founder of the entire thing. It was a pretty radical weekend with these two, and the Lord spoke to me about going back to the U.S. to complete an accelerated Bachelor's of Science in Nursing using this time with Linda, and David was the founder. I finished the last week the YWAM base of the fast at the YWAM base in Christ Church, where I could share with the whole staff and the snowboarders DTS about what the Lord had done. We saw radical miracles, radical breakthrough in so many people's lives. 7 days later, I turned 25, and a week later, I was boarding a flight back to Chicago, where I would then apply to a difficult nursing school and find myself being supernaturally accepted with not all the credits I needed. Those 40 days, I had such incredible intimacy with Jesus. I learned who he was and how to be completely dependent on him for absolutely everything. Guys, I want to close with this. I share this with you because when Pastor Tim was here, I forgot about these fasts. It's not something on my heart, and my dear parents are like living between two houses, and she sent me two boxes of stuff, and in one of the boxes was all of these journals of my heart poured out of what the Lord did, and I started reading them at night to Joshua, and it was just, I was just bawling, just looking at what the Lord had done and how quickly I could forget of these amazing things that he did in and through me and just get in my seat here and just feel comfy coming in on Wednesdays and Sundays and doing what I feel is the bare minimum and not really pressing myself to walk into prayer and fasting, to move into greater words of knowledge, gifts of healing, to see these things that I did. And when Tim Hall said, someone here tonight needs to know that God misses you. He misses your first love. When Pastor Tim went out to that mountain, God said, I miss the old Tim. How many can say that God's probably saying about that to us tonight? I miss the old Allie. I miss that person that fasted for 40 days. 40 days, I'm like, I for sure will die. My parents thought I was going to die, for sure. They're like, this is crazy. You need to come home today. You have no place to live. You're not eating. You're crazy. I said, no, this is Jesus. This is Jesus. And clearly, I've never been more fit, more, built up in my spirit man from that fast, but never have I had such a reliance of the things of God in my life. I had body image problems. I had pride issues. I had, issues from my childhood. I had crazy stuff broken in those 40 days. When I read through my journal yesterday and today to prepare for tonight, I was like, I did? I struggled with that? That was what? They were big issues, guys. These were big go to therapy issues. I couldn't even remember that I even had them. That I had those problems. Praise God, right? We're changed from glory to glory, twinkling of an eye. Amen. As far as the east from the west, thank you, Jesus. It's buried so far in the ocean, I forgot about it. But I want you guys to open up to Isaiah 58. We're going to start in verse 6, and I strongly believe that this is a mandate for our church, you guys. Pastor spoke about it, Tim Hall spoke about it, and the Lord put it heavy on my heart. That this is a season for us as a church, and you don't have to do anything, right? You can just be like, that's cool, I'm not really going to do that. Or you can say, Lord, I want to go back to the first love. I want to be that first person when I was first saved, so desperate after you. I want to move into prayer and fasting, even though it freaks me out. I want to move into that. And you know what? It can start small potatoes. You can start with lunchtime. You can start with, fasting little things. And all of a sudden, you might be that person in a 40-day fast, losing your complete self to gain his. So Isaiah 58, verse 6, it says, is not this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and that you bring the poor that are cast out to your house? When you see the naked, that you cover him, and that you hide not yourself from your own flesh, then shall your light break forth as the morning, and your health shall bring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. There's no other rear guard I'd rather have than the glory of the mighty, mighty God. Then shall you call, and the Lord shall answer. You shall cry, and he shall say, here I am. If you take away from the midst of the yoke, the pointing the finger, and the speaking wickedness, and if you draw out of your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall your light rise in the darkness, and your darkness be as the noonday. And the Lord shall guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones, and you shall be like a water garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. And they from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall rise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets to dwell in. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your own pleasures on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall share honor, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, not finding our own pleasure, nor speaking your own words, then shall you delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to rise upon the heights of the earth and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Guys, tonight's our night. I know you thought you just came to chill on Thanksgiving Eve and get out of cooking or baking or whatever else you do. But tonight's our night to pull away from that lukewarmness or that I'm kind of comfortable in my job and in my spot. I'm talking to myself. Again, I'm just glad you guys are here. I'm talking to myself. I'm talking to myself about moving into greater anointing of the Lord, greater prophetic gifts. I know prayer and fasting does that. I know you're like, you're 6 months pregnant. Please don't go fasting like you're feeding a child. There's other things that we can be doing, that we can be fasting from, that we can saturate ourselves in the Word of God, right? So I want to make a public declaration. Don't do this if you're not in it to win it, because God sees it, right? And he'll harden your heart if you're like, yeah, I'm totally in because everyone's looking at me. If you're not in it, no worries. Let God fix that out. But if you want to change, if you want to step up and say, this is me, I'm going to start praying, fasting for this church. I'm going to start praying and fasting for Cuba, San Diego, my family. I mean, my brother and I are the bestest of friends because he loves Jesus. He married a Holy Ghost woman. They love Jesus. They just had a beautiful, beautiful baby. But that all came out of that 40-day fast. I forgot that until I opened that up and saw that in my own journal. I was like, what? This all came to what? I give him a Bible for his college graduation. He's like, dude, did you get me anything else? I'm like, no, it's the Bible. It's the Word of God. He wasn't ready. But when I started fasting, he started getting hungry for that little red Bible that I got him for $20, right? He still has that same Bible. And it's been amazing to see what's gone on in his life. He was a professional golfer with Bubba Watson and Aaron Badley and these other Christian men, and got to see radical things happen. But I want to put you guys up to that tonight. I want to say, how many of us have unsaved family members that we know are on their way to hell that we need to press in for? You know, prayer and fasting can be your ticket to see things happen in your family. And we can't let Satan just be like, oh no, it's just what it is. No. This is our spiritual warfare. This is what the Lord has given us. What Tim Hall came and said, hey, weapons of warfare right here, prayer and fasting. I have to admit, after he said it, I'm like, that sounds good. Did I do it? No, I didn't. A couple weeks went by and then the Lord's like, you're up Wednesday night. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do it. So who's going to do it? Come on. We're going to do this thing. I appreciate all those hands up. You know why? Because God sees it, and he's going to be the one that supernaturally strengthens us. You won't die. I'm still here. I've only done one 40-day. Pastor Hall, I think he does one a year. He did? Yeah, one a year. And there's a lot of ministers that do them 3 times a year. But we're not going to die. But we are going to see massive breakthrough in our lives and our families and this nation. I mean, there's never been a more critical time that we're praying and on our knees in prayer and fasting. So everyone, please stand with me. I love you guys. I am so grateful that you're all here. I'm so grateful that we're going to not even be able to witness each other, because Martha, you're gonna look like a totally new person, changing from glory to glory, because you're gonna have this shining face that you're so stuck into the things of God that we're just gonna be renewed day by day. And so, Father, I thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you for this mandate of this church, Lord, that we would come into prayer and fasting, Lord Jesus, that we'd be supernaturally strengthened to see all these miracles, signs, wonders that you want to do here in San Diego, Father, that the strongholds would be broken over our city, Father, the strongholds be broken over our nation and over our families, Father. I thank you, Lord, that we would press in, that we'd be bared up for the fight, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you right now. Father, we will not back down, Father, but we would be strengthened in the Holy Ghost tonight, Father. Tonight. Tonight, Lord Jesus, strengthened. Father, we give you all the praise, all the thanksgiving, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you that you've called us chosen as a church. Just cry out to the Lord, whatever you see, whatever breakthrough you need to see in your life, for your church, for this family. In Jesus' name, you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. So good. Let's give him a praise in this place. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, that you've raised us up as deliverers out of Mount Zion, just as you spoke through your prophet Obadiah, that you would raise up deliverers out of Mount Zion. We thank you, Lord, that that's what you purposed us to do, to go forth, setting the captives free, laying hands on the sick, seeing them recover, seeing the miracles, the mighty miracles of Jesus Christ manifested as the true King of kings and Lord of lords, the King of glory. We thank you, Lord, that you've raised us up as deliverers out of Mount Zion, proclaiming and executing the authority of the kingdom, as ambassadors of heaven, as ambassadors of the kingdom of the Most High God. And we take our place, we take our stand. We rise in your strength, Lord, in the power of your might. We take our place, we take our stand. We arise in the strength of the Lord, in the power of his might. We take our place, we take our stand. Rise in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. We take our place, we take our stand. We rise in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Take our place, we take our stand. We rise in the strength of the Lord, the power of his might. We take our place, we take our stand. We rise in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Take our place, we take our stand. We arrive in the strength of the Lord, the power of his might. Feel free to worship with us. Feel free to come and present your offering to the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Bring in worship, bring in praise. We take our stand. We arise in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. From strength to strength, from glory to glory, from strength to strength, from glory to glory. Lord, and the power of his mind. praise shall continually be on our lips. Lord, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Lord, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips, oh Lord. Your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips, Lord. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Thanksgiving. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips, Lord. Your praise shall continually be on. Your praises, the high praises in our mouth, the high praises in our mouth. Give him faith, give him faith. Sing in your praise, sing in your praise. Will your praise shout? Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips, oh Lord. Your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips, Lord. Your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips. Oh, your praise shall continually be on our lips. God. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the rejoicing. Oh, you'll find me in the place of those given things. Oh, you'll find me place of the rejoice. Oh, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks, in the place of the mighty, in the place of the mighty, in the place of the mighty, of those who have strayed, in the place of the mighty, in the place of the mighty, place of the mighty, those who have strength. Find me in the place of the rejoice. Well, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the rejoice. Oh, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. In the place of the mighty. In the place of the mighty. In the place of those who have strength. In the place of the mighty. Place of the mighty, in the place of the mighty, those who have place of the rejoicing. Oh, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Oh, you'll find me in the place of the rejoicing. Oh, you'll find me in the place of giving thanks. Your praise shall continually be on my lips. Your praise shall continually be on my lips. But your praise shall continually be on my lips. For your praise shall continually be on. Your praise shall continually be on my lips. But your praise shall continually be on my lips. Your praise shall continually be on my lips, oh Lord. Continually be on my lips. Will your praise shall continually be on my lips. I'll be in the place of love and joy. Continually be on my lips, but your praise shall continually.